We have now reached topic 9, accounting and reporting in foreign operations. Speaking of foreign operations, did you know that the Bible talks about how we should relate to foreigners? Moses speaking to the Israelites just before they enter the promised land after 40 years in the wilderness. And this is what Moses said in Deuteronomy chapter 10, verses 19 and 20. He said, "And you are to love those who are foreigners, for you yourselves were foreigners in Egypt." And verse 20 says, "Fear the Lord your God and serve him, hold fast to him, and take your oaths in his name." It reminds me of the importance of looking back at where we come from and never forgetting the experiences that we have had. I'd like to share too this favorite quote from the Philippine national hero Jose Rizal. He said, "He who does not know how to look back at where he came from will never get to his destination." Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we are so grateful, O Lord, that you have given us your words of wisdom, words to live by. And I pray, O Lord, that each one of us will learn to hold fast to you all the time. Increase our faith, O Lord. And as we go through this topic today, we pray for the Holy Spirit's guidance. And we pray that we will always surrender our will to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In topic 9, we are going to cover 7 learning objectives. We will focus on the first 5 learning objectives in part A of this lecture, focusing on foreign operations, including foreign currency translation and remeasurement. And then in part B, we will cover the last 2 learning objectives on reporting for segments. We'll begin our discussion with learning objective 1. This is where we'll have an understanding of what a foreign subsidiary's functional currency is and its importance. A foreign subsidiary's financial statements, which are expressed in foreign currency units, must first be transformed into the parent's currency units before the consolidation process begins. The transformation under US GAAP specifies one of 2 procedures, and the procedure that is chosen will depend on the foreign subsidiary's operating characteristics. The first method is known as the current rate method. Foreign subsidiaries that are essentially freestanding units with self-contained foreign operations are translated using current rate method. On the other hand, foreign subsidiaries that are mere extensions of the parent and those subsidiaries that have no self-sufficiency will be remeasured using the second approach, and that is the temporal method. The procedure selected to transform subsidiary statements expressed in foreign currency units into the parent's currency units is based on the functional currency. Functional currency is simply the currency in which the subsidiary effectively operates. In Exhibit 18.1, we are shown here the indicators of the appropriate functional currency. So there are several indicators. The first one is the cash flows. We won't go into all these indicators, but let's just have a look as to how we know whether the functional currency is the foreign currency or the functional currency is the parent entity's currency. Let's just suppose that the parent company is in the US, and so the parent entity's currency is US dollars, And if they have, for example, a subsidiary in the UK and they are using British pounds over there, then the foreign currency is British pounds. So if cash flow is the indicator, when cash flows related to the foreign entity's individual assets and liabilities are primarily in the foreign currency and do not directly affect the parent entity's cash flows, then we can say that the functional currency is the foreign currency. On the other hand, if cash flows related to the foreign entity's individual assets and liabilities directly affect the parent's cash flows currently and are readily available for remittance to the parent entity, then that means that the functional currency is the parent entity's currency. So you can apply similar principles for sales price, sales market, expenses, financing, and intra-entity transactions and arrangements in determining whether the functional currency is, for example, British pounds, or whether the functional currency is the US dollars. However, notwithstanding any of these indicators shown in Exhibit 18.1, if a subsidiary operates in a hyperinflationary economy, then the US dollar is considered to be the functional currency. So hyperinflationary economy just means that when inflation is very high, then that means that economy is hyperinflationary. So for example, a multinational company headquartered in the US has a subsidiary in South Africa, and the South African rand is very, very volatile because of hyperinflation in the country, then even if the foreign currency is the functional currency, that means South African rand, then US dollars will still be considered the functional currency. All right, let's have a look at Exhibit 18.2. This shows the comparison of the two methods mentioned earlier, the current rate and the temporal methods. And this gives us the general concepts in accounting for foreign subsidiaries. So when the functional currency is the local currency, the method that would be used must be the current rate. Therefore, assets or liabilities will be converted to US dollars at the current exchange rate at the time of the transaction, and all assets and liabilities will be subjected to revaluation. Also, the gains or losses are recognized as other comprehensive income, OCI. And whenever there is derecognition of existing asset or liability, then when the functional currency is the local currency, there is a need to remove the corresponding US dollar amount based on current exchange rate at the time of the recognition. However, if the functional currency is the parent entity's currency, say the US dollar, then the temporal method will be used, and the change in exchange rate will affect all monetary assets and liabilities, just the monetary assets and liabilities. All right, the gains or the loss are recorded under the temporal method as the net income, not OCI. And when there is derecognition of existing asset or liability, then under the temporal method, if a monetary asset or liability is being derecognized, remove the corresponding US dollar amount based on the current exchange rate at the time of derecognition. If a non-monetary asset or liability is being removed, then remove the corresponding US dollar amount based on the exchange rate at the time asset or liability was first recognized. That means the historical exchange rate. All right, we will apply this as we go through a comparison of current rate and temporal method using illustration. And this is when we'll go to learning objectives 2 and 3. So in learning objective 2, we learn how financial statements are translated under the current rate method when the functional currency is the subsidiary's local currency. And in learning objective 3, we learn how financial statements are remeasured, not translated, but remeasured under the temporal method when the functional currency is the parent's home currency. So let us have a look at the main characteristics of a foreign subsidiary that will use the current rate method. When functional currency is the local currency, the current rate method will be used, and the process, as what we've said, is called translation. All assets and liabilities are revalued in US dollar terms continuously so that they always reflect the current exchange rate. What do we do with gains or losses under the current rate method? Well, this will be recognized as OCI, other comprehensive income. The application of the current rate method implies that when transactions occur evenly throughout the period, then the income statement amounts are translated using the average exchange rate for the accounting period. Now let's look at the temporal method. The temporal method is used when the US dollar is the foreign subsidiary's functional currency. Under the temporal method, only monetary assets and monetary liabilities are revalued when the exchange rate changes. So monetary assets are your cash, your accounts receivable, marketable securities, and the like. Monetary liabilities are, of course, your accounts payable and the like. What do we do with non-monetary assets under the temporal method? Non-monetary assets and non-monetary liabilities continue to be reflected in the US dollar balance sheet at the historical exchange rate from when they were first recognized, even as the exchange rates change. So your non-monetary assets, like, for example, inventory, and non-monetary liabilities like accrued revenues, will be at historical exchange rate. Finally, gains and losses are reported in the income statement. So it's not considered OCI under the temporal method. Let's look at an illustrative example and see how current rate method and temporal method would differ. Suppose a US company establishes a British subsidiary called Intan PLC on the 1st of January 2021. They invested £100,000. The exchange rate at that time is $1.48. The parent company converts $148,000 to £100,000. And they use it to purchase the common stock of Intan. Now, Intan records the investment in its books. By January 31st, 2021, the exchange rate has fallen to $1.47. On that date, Intan purchases inventory at a cost of £60,000. So under the current rate method, on January 1st, 2021, cash and common stock will be debited and credited for £100,000. The equivalent entry in US dollars would be to debit cash and credit common stock for $148,000. The same journal entry will be done under the temporal method. So in January 31st, 2021, when the exchange rate has fallen from 148 to 147, there's a difference of 1 cent. So there will be a need to record an OCI, other comprehensive income from currency translation. How much? The difference of 1 cent times £100,000. So we will be debiting OCI currency translation for $1,000 and credit cash $1,000. This is to revalue all assets and liabilities in accordance with the new exchange rate of 147. Now, on the same date, January 31st, the company purchased inventory of 60,000 pounds and so they'll debit inventory 60,000 pounds and credit cash for 60,000 pounds. In US dollars, the journal entry would be to debit inventory and credit cash for $88,200. How did we get that? It's simply 60,000 pounds times $1.47. So that's the entry under current rate method. What about under temporal method? First, we'll need to recognize a foreign exchange loss. Remember that under temporal method, any gains and losses will be considered in the income statement. All right, so instead of OCI, we'll be debiting foreign exchange loss, $1,000, and credit cash for the same amount. The journal entry for the purchase of inventory of 60,000 pounds will be the same under both temporal and current rate method. And in US dollars, it will also be the same. Debit inventory, 88,200, and credit cash for the same amount. Now let's continue. Suppose that on the 29th of February, 20X1, it sells one third of its inventory for 25,000 pounds when the exchange rate is $1.45. And then it sells another one third of the original inventory on March 15, 20X1, again for 25,000 pounds. And the exchange rate at that time is 144. So let's look at the entry using the current rate method first. On the 29th of February, there is a need to recognize the loss from $1.47 to 145. So there is a difference of 2 cents now. We'll need to recognize an OCI of 2 cents times 100,000 pounds. That's still the total of the assets and liabilities. So debit OCI, currency translation $2,000, and credit cash for how much? Well, how much is our cash? We purchased 60,000 pounds worth of inventory. So we still have 40,000 pounds of cash. So 40,000 pounds times 2 cents, it will give us $800. So we'll credit cash 800. And we now have inventory of how much? 60,000 pounds. So 60,000 times 2 cents will give us 1,200. So inventory will be credited for that amount. Also on the same date, there was a sale of 25,000 pounds representing one third of the inventory. So we purchased 60,000 pounds of inventory and now one third of that is sold. So the journal entry in pounds will be debit cash and credit sales revenue for 25,000 pounds, and we'll need to also recognize the cost of goods sold. So cost of goods sold will be debited for 20,000 pounds and credit inventory for the same amount. In US dollars, we'll be debiting cash for 36,250. That's simply 25,000 pounds times the rate at that time, which is $1.45, all right? And the credit is to sales revenue for the same amount, 36,250. Cost of goods sold will be debited for 29,000 and inventory will be credited for the same amount. So 29,000 is simply the 20,000 pounds times $1.45. All right, so that's current rate method. How do we journalize this if it's the temporal method being used? Remember that any gains and losses under the temporal method will be recognized in the income statement. So we will recognize foreign exchange loss and therefore we'll debit foreign exchange loss for how much? Only $800, because under the temporal method, it's only the monetary assets and liabilities that will need to be remeasured. All right, so inventory is non-monetary, so there's no need to recognize the foreign exchange loss for inventory. What else do we need to do? We'll need to, of course, journalize the cash sales and the cost of goods sold corresponding to it. The journal entry in British pounds will be the same as in current rate method. To record the cash sales, you notice that the journal entry under current rate method and temporal method are also the same. However, in terms of the cost of goods sold, the amount that we need to debit would be 29,400 and inventory should be credited for the same amount. How did we get 29,400? It is simply 20,000 pounds times $1.47. Why are we using $1.47? Because under temporal method, non-monetary assets and liabilities will be derecognized. This is what we're doing here. We are derecognizing inventory at the historical exchange rate, not at the current rate. Let's move on to transaction on March 15. In March 15, we sold another 25,000 pounds and the exchange rate at that time is 144. So under the current rate method, we now need to recognize another OCI from currency translation because the exchange rate changed from 145 to 144. There is a difference of 1 cent. So how much is the OCI? In this case, 1 cent times the net assets. We now have 105,000 pounds. So 105,000 pounds times 1 cent is 1,050 US dollars. And what do we credit? We'll credit cash and inventory. How much is our cash now? We have 40,000 before plus this 25,000 cash sales. So we now have 65,000 pounds times 1 cent. So that's 650 US dollars. What about inventory? We purchased 60,000 pounds of inventory, but we have sold 20,000 on the 29th of Feb. So we still have 40,000 pounds worth of inventory. 40,000 times 1 cent, so that will give us inventory decrease in value of $400. Once we've journalized the OCI, we can now enter the sales. We'll debit cash and credit sales for 25,000 pounds and we'll debit cost of goods sold and inventory for 20,000 pounds. Then we'll also need to record that in US dollars. So cash will be debited for $36,000 and sales will be credited for the same amount. So 36,000 is simply $1.44 times 25,000 pounds. The cost of goods sold will be debited for 28,800 and inventory will be credited for the same amount in US dollars. So we are just converting 20,000 pounds at the current exchange rate of 144, so that's 28,800. How about under the temporal method? There is a need first to recognize the loss. So the foreign exchange loss will be debited for $650 and will credit cash for $650. Again, remember why we are not journalizing the loss on inventory, because inventory is non-monetary asset. Under the temporal method, we only recognize gains and losses on monetary assets and liabilities. The journal entry for British pounds and the US dollars for cash sales will be the same, but the journal entry for the cost of goods sold will be a little bit different under the temporal method. So we'll debit cost of goods sold for 29,400 and credit inventory for 29,400. How did we get that? It's simply 20,000 pounds times the historical exchange rate of $1.47. So that's mainly the difference between current rate and temporal method. All right, let's move on to the end of the quarter. When the quarter ends on 31st March 20X1, the exchange rate is $1.46. So from 144 to 146. There's 2 cents difference. Under the current rate method, we will now need to recognize an OCI on currency translation of 2,200. How did we get that? 2 cents from 144 to 146. There is an increase of 2 cents in the exchange rate. So 2 cents multiplied by 110,000 pounds. We now have 110,000 in total assets. What is that? That's actually the cash of 90,000 and inventory of 20,000. Remember, we have 40,000 cash left and then we sold twice for 25,000 pounds each. So 50,000 plus 40,000, 90,000. So 90,000 cash multiplied by 2 cents will give us 1,800. So we'll debit cash 1,800 and we have 20,000 pounds in inventory that is left. So 20,000 times 2 cents, that would give us 400. So inventory will be debited for $400. What about under the temporal method? We will debit only cash because cash is the only monetary asset there. Inventory isn't. So we will debit cash for 1,800 and we will credit foreign exchange gain for 1,800 to revalue only the monetary asset. We don't have liabilities in this case. All right. The resulting financial statements for the current rate method will look like this. So you've got cash of 90,000 pounds in the local currency, and that is translated 131,400 in US dollars. Inventory is 20,000 pounds, 29,200 in US dollars. So you've got there the common stock, the retained earnings and all that. That's your balance sheet. And in the lower part, you will see the income statement showing the sales and the cost of goods sold and, of course, the net income as shown. Notice that there is no foreign exchange gain or loss in the income statement using the current rate method. Why is that? Because any gains or loss in foreign exchange is shown as OCI. Under the temporal method, your balance sheet will also show 110,000 pounds total liabilities and stockholders' equity. But notice that the value in US dollars is slightly different. It's 160,800. And in the income statement, you will notice that there is foreign exchange loss, in this case, of $650. There's also a little bit of difference in terms of the value for the cost of goods sold. All right, let us now go to learning objective 4. This is where we will explain the translation or the remeasurement exposure and how it relates to gains and losses in translated or remeasured financial statements. So remember, when we are using current rate method, we are translating. When we are using the temporal method, we are remeasuring. So what is this translation or remeasurement exposure? Translation and remeasurement exposure comprises the net asset appearing on the local currency balance sheet that are subject to revaluation in US dollar terms if the exchange rate changes. Under the current rate method, all assets and liabilities are subject to revaluation, as we have seen in the illustrative example. So the translation exposure is equal to the net assets in the local currency. On the other hand, under the temporal method, only the monetary assets and liabilities are subject to revaluation. So remeasurement exposure is equal to net monetary assets in the local currency. Why is it important to know this exposure? It's important because the amount of gain or loss that arises over a period relates to the change in exchange rate, but also on the level of exposure. So we will see here the proving out of the translation adjustment. So under the current rate method, we can see in Exhibit 18.7 that the sub-periods are provided there in Panel A. So from January 1st to February 29, 20X1, we have the translation exposure being all the assets and liabilities, 100,000 pounds, all right? At the beginning, the rate was 148, at the end is 145. And so the net change is 3 cents and there's a reduction. So the translation adjustment is 3,000. Now from February 29 to March 15, the net assets and liabilities is now 105,000 pounds. So that's the translation exposure. There is a net change in exchange rate of 1 cent. So the translation adjustment is 1,050. From March 15 to the end of the quarter, we now have 110,000 pounds. And there was a net change in the exchange rate of increase of 2 cents positive. So we have translation adjustment of 2,200 and the total of that is negative 1,850. In panel B, you will see there the translation exposure, the exchange rate, and the US dollar amount. What you notice is that the change in exposure shows the net income that has been recognized added to the initial investment. All right. And so the translation exposure and US dollar amount at 31st of March 20X1, had there been no revaluations, would have been 110,000 pounds and 162,450 in US dollars. Now consider the balance sheet that we have looked at earlier. You will notice that the net income as recognized is 10,000 pounds and $14,450. And the total liabilities and stockholders' equity of 110,000 represents the translation exposure and US dollar amount corresponding to that is 160,600. When you compare 160,600, the translation exposure in US dollars, with the US dollar amount, had there been no revaluations of 162,450, you will see that's the translation adjustment of $1,850 negative. All right, let's prove the translation adjustment under the temporal method. What is the remeasurement exposure? It's only the monetary asset or liability. In this case, we don't have monetary liability, so it's just the monetary asset, 90,000 pounds. All right. And so when we actually look at the balance sheet as shown in the previous slide, which is reproduced here, the revenue recognized, which is 50,000 pounds in US dollars, is $72,250, is shown here as change in exposure. So you start, of course, with the remeasurement exposure and the US dollar amount, and then the change in exposure, your inventory purchased and revenue recognized. When you total that up, that gives you the remeasurement exposure and US dollar amount at 31st of March 20X1, had there been no revaluations, which is simply representing the amount in the monetary assets or liabilities. And here, the remeasurement exposure, as what I've mentioned earlier, is limited to the monetary asset, which is the cash of 90,000 pounds, and in US dollars, that's 131,400. When you compare that with the US dollar amount, had there been no revaluation, which is 132,050 as shown there, that would give you the foreign exchange loss that we have calculated earlier, which is $650. All right. Now let us move to learning objective 5. We will understand how common financial statement metrics are affected by translation or remeasurement and how to account for foreign currency transactions entered into by a US company. So let's start with the common financial statement metrics. Two of the more important effects of consolidating foreign subsidiaries are on reported revenue growth rates and operating margins. The revenue growth rates can be affected by changes in exchange rates. Now, a dramatic effect occurs when the temporal method is used, and the cost of goods sold and many other expenses for that matter are converted into US dollars using a lagged exchange rate. So as a result, the operating margin percentage derived from the subsidiary's local currency income statement is not preserved. Generally though, the margin percentage will be higher or lower when the value of the foreign currency has been increasing or decreasing. So the margin percentage will be higher if the value of foreign currency is increasing, and it will be lower when the value of the foreign currency is decreasing. In Exhibit 18.17, you will see here a very quick illustration of the impact of foreign currency translation or remeasurement on the gross margin. So you'll see here that when we're talking about local currency, all right, the gross margin as shown here is 20%. So that's simply the gross profit of 10,000 pounds divided by 50,000 pounds. So that's 20%, right? Now let's look at the two columns under US dollars. The current rate method will show that the sales equivalent is 72,250 and the gross profit is 14,450. So when you calculate the gross margin using the current rate method, you will also get 20%, 14,450 divided by 72,250 will give you the same gross margin percentage of 20%. But under the temporal method, this is why it says the dramatic effect occurs when the temporal method is used. So under the temporal method, notice that the gross profit is 13,450 US dollars. If you divide that by 72,250 sales, you get a gross margin of only 18.6%. So what we have seen here is that the foreign currency has been what? Decreasing in the case of Intan PLC example. And that's the reason why the margin percentage as shown in this example using the temporal method is lower compared to the local currency's gross margin percentage. All right. Now let's consider Exhibit 18.16 as we look at the revenue growth rates in the financial statement analysis. The growth rates in an income statement, say the revenue, based on the amounts in the consolidated financial statements can be affected by changes in exchange rates. Consider Cyber 2 Corporation in Exhibit 18.16. This is a Hong Kong subsidiary of a US company. Now, Cyber 2 had revenues of 300 million Hong Kong dollars in 20X1 and 350 million Hong Kong dollars in 20X2. Suppose the Hong Kong dollar increased in value relative to the US dollar, so that the average exchange rate in 20X1 was 1 Hong Kong dollar is equal to 0.125 US dollars. And the average exchange rate in 20X2 was 1 Hong Kong dollar is equal to 0.131 US dollars. Further, suppose the Hong Kong dollar was worth 0.132 US dollars at the end of 20X2. So Exhibit 18.16 shows the revenue growth rates for Cyber 2 based on its results in both currencies, as well as the cost of change analysis on the US dollar revenue amounts. As you can see in panel A, Cyber 2's revenue growth rate based on its local currency financial statement was 16.67% in 20X2 versus 20X1. So how did we get that? It's simply 20X2 sales revenue of 350 million minus 300 million, that's 50 million, divided by 20X1 sales of 300 million. So that gives us 16.67%. However, the growth in US dollar revenues, which are the amounts that are consolidated into the parent's financial statements, was 22.27%. So that's just 45.85 million minus 37.5 million US dollars. Then divide by 37.5 and that gives us 22.27%. Now, focus on panel B this time. Panel B shows the cost of change analysis similar to the one we have discussed earlier. What it does is it disaggregates the 8.35 million US dollar increase in reported sales into the portion due to the increase in local currency sales and the change in the exchange rate. First, we multiply 50 million Hong Kong dollars increase in revenue by the 20x1 average exchange rate 0.125 to arrive at 6.25 million US dollars increase in US dollar sales. So this is the portion of the increase in US dollar sales that is due to the increase in local currency sales. The additional 2.1 million US dollars increase in US dollar sales was because of the increase in the value of Hong Kong dollar. So the question is, why does an analyst care about the components of the sales growth? Well, suppose that you want to forecast sales for the coming year. You believe that prior growth is a reasonable starting point to estimate growth in the next year. Which growth rate do you think is more useful in this case? Is it the 16.67% based on Hong Kong dollars, or is it the 22.27% based on US dollars? Well, the answer to this is most likely the 16.67%. Why is that? Well, it's because even though the prior growth rates might be an indicator of future growth, the same may not necessarily be true with the exchange rates. So an increase or decrease in the value of a currency in 1 year does not necessarily imply a similar magnitude of change in the next year, or even a change in the same direction. For all you know, it might actually be decreasing in the next year as far as the exchange rate is concerned. All right, let's now go to the second part of learning objective 5, and that is foreign currency transactions. What are foreign currency transactions? These are transactions that are denominated in a currency other than the one in which the company presents its financial statements. So here, we are not talking about the operations of the foreign subsidiary, but rather the operations of the company that may transact in a foreign currency. So how is this done? This is accounted for similar to the temporal method. That is, the monetary assets like the cash, accounts receivable, marketable securities, and the monetary liabilities like the accounts or the debts payable are revalued at the current rate. So the gains and losses on the revaluations will also be recognized in the net income, just like in temporal method. So here is an illustration. Let's assume that we have the same transactions as in the Intan example, except that we are assuming that a US company called Sykes Corporation entered into those transactions directly, and instead of investing £100,000, Sykes purchases inventory worth £1,000 at a cost of $148,000. All right, so the journal entries at the beginning of January 20X1, when the inventory was purchased for £100,000 at the cost of $148,000 will be debit cash, British pound account, $148,000, and credit cash, US dollar account, $148,000. On January 31st, 20X1, they will then be recognizing $1,000 of foreign exchange loss. So they'll debit foreign exchange loss of $1,000 and credit cash British pound account for $1,000. That is revaluing the foreign currency held to the new exchange rate of $1.47. Then when they purchase the inventory, they'll debit inventory and credit cash for $88,200. That is at the rate of $1.47. On the 29th of February 20X1, when the foreign currency further reduced to 145, then they will be debiting foreign exchange loss of $800 and credit cash for $800. They will also be debiting cash British pound account for $36,250 and credit the sales revenue for $36,250, representing the sales of their inventory worth £25,000. They will have to also recognize the cost of goods sold, so debit cost of goods sold and credit inventory for $29,400. So remember that cost of goods sold is supposed to be recorded at the historical exchange rate at $1.47. Now on March 15, they will be again recognizing another foreign exchange loss because the value of the currency decreased by another 1 cent. So foreign exchange loss will be debited for $650 and credit cash British pound account for $650. Then they'll record the next batch of sales, debiting cash, British pound account, $36,000, and credit sales revenue for $36,000. This time, they are using the exchange rate of $1.44. So $25,000 times $1.44. The cost of goods sold, debit, and credit to inventory will be again at the historical exchange rate of $1.47. So £20,000 times 147 is $29,400. And finally, on the 31st of March 20X1, the foreign currency increased by 2 cents from 144 to 146. So they will be multiplying 2 cents by the amount of cash. The cash is £90,000. So 90,000 times 2 cents will give us 1,800, and therefore we'll debit cash British pound account 1,800 and credit foreign exchange gain for the same amount. All right, well, we will stop here for a while and we will continue with the rest of the learning objectives in part B of this lecture. Bye-bye for now.